For those that don't know me, there's a couple of our guys in here. I'm Captain Chad Burr of Denver Fire, work on Engine 15. I'm also your former Health and Benefits Director. I just moved down from that position last month. Been in the cancer committee since its inception. I'm also a cancer survivor. So this is way personal to me. We started working on Resolution 25 is something that our local, if you guys don't know the background of it, is we started working on a resolution to force the IFF to start providing this education, funding, and prevention efforts from their level, from the international. Next year, we're going to see a lot of things rolled out with the assistance of the Cancer Support Network, and it all started with our resolution and started in our community. In those talks, in getting Resolution 25 going and passed, we started developing a relationship with the Firefighter Cancer Support Network and Keith Tyson. We started hearing about this class, and we all were very interested in bringing them out, trying to give us a good class. This kind of piggybacks a lot of what Kimsey did before, but it's much more in depth and there's a lot more information. Just a couple caveats before I introduce Keith. Most of you probably already know or heard from him. Is remember that what he says in this class is just an instructor, and this is the local putting this on. This is not the fire department putting on. This is luckily the administration division and the operations, or administration and the operations division have agreed to let on-duty companies come out and do an in-service. But so with that set aside, I'd like to introduce Keith Tyson, Firefighter Cancer Support Network, retired firefighter out of Metro Dade County Fire in Florida. So it's all yours.
Okay, kind of piggyback upon what Chad was saying earlier. When we met in Philly, it was one of those issues where, you know, your union was coming up with Resolution 25, and we sat down with them, and there was a lot of talk on the floor from a lot of unions that said, no, we're not going to pass this thing because it's going to cost the members money, and as we all know, we're all getting cutbacks and this and the other. So when we actually sat down with them at the Health and Safety Committee, we basically said, here's our program, and we gave it to every member on the Health and Safety Committee from the IFF, and when it was over and done with, basically it went to the floor and it got totally passed. So it was really one of those issues that really came out very well for everybody concerned. It was a good cohesive group of going on together. The class was originally called the 800-pound gorilla in the fire service. And there's a reason for that. We call them cancer. But the reason is, for far too long, we've kind of ignored this little thing. You can call it the white elephant if you prefer. But it's this little gorilla that's been in the corner of the room. If we ignore it, it'll go away. You know, we won't talk about it, it'll go away. And unfortunately, not only are we not talking about it, but it's growing up. And now it's gotten out of the cage, gotten out of that corner of the room, and it's rampant across the departments, all across the country. And you know, we'll talk about numbers here in a few minutes. But it's crazy when you really sit down and say, here's the numbers of what's going on. I mean, it was eye-opening to a lot of people. So here's what we're going to talk about today. The Cancer Support Network, the who, the what, and why we exist. It's a brief overview. We'll talk about some of the cardiac and cancer histories. And when I say local, I mean more Florida, but there's also some national numbers. And during break time, or right after the first break, we'll talk about your department. Cancer exposures, fire and chemical exposures. It's not a hazmat class, I don't get into it in depth, but it's kind of a reawareness as to, if you're exposed to this, this might happen. Safe work habits, it's kind of a show and tell. We show you some pictures and say, is this right? Is this wrong? What's the problems here? NFPA and the fire service, both 1500 and 1851. What should you be doing for yourself? What should the department be doing for you? And or is either one of you doing it? And lastly, changes for the future. What can we do differently? What should you be doing differently? And where should we be going in the future? So as far as the Cancer Support Network, you're the officer on the truck. One morning, one of your backstep people walks in and says, hey, Cap, I've just been diagnosed with cancer and I might be out for a couple months. Hell, the doctor even said it might be a couple of years. What do you say to them? Where do you turn to? You know, do you have the information that you need out there to kind of discuss it intelligently? Do you know what they're even going to go through? I mean, unless you've actually been down that cancer road, so to speak, it's real hard to be able to talk to somebody intelligently and say, hey, I understand what you're going through. Listen, it's a difficult time. We've been there. We've done that. We'll walk alongside you and kind of help and guide you. I mean, we all have our benevolent associations that will be able to sit there and assist, bring meals and that type of thing. But can you actually sit and tell them, hey, this is what's going to happen. this might happen to you, this might not happen to you, this is what happened to me, and then go from that point. Our mission statement, the first part of our mission statement in our organization is to provide an opportunity to receive assistance and mentoring when dealing with cancer. If you were to have been diagnosed with any type of cancer, you can call our 800 number. And Debbie Pike, who's the director for mentoring, will immediately ask you a few questions. What type of cancer? What are your options? Does your department know about it? Do you care if your department knows about it? And a couple other questions, real quick questions like that. Sometimes people say, I don't care if my department knows or not. I'm not going to get into that with you here. But if you say, no, my department doesn't know and I don't want them to know, the immediate first response is, we're going to find you a mentor across the country. I mean, we all know about telephone, telegraph, and telefirefighters, so we're going to try to keep it away from you within your own department type thing. So, you know, we'll get you someone who's similar in age, very similar, if not the identical type of cancer, and sit down with you and kind of walk you through what they've already gone through. Additionally, we send out a box of information about the type of cancer and some guidelines and a file folder and keep your records and keep your doctor's business cards. And when you go see the doctor, get a copy of that report so that when you go see the next doctor for a second opinion or go see somebody else in Texas for your treatment, all your records are right there. Here it is. This is what I've gone through already. Things we don't typically think about when we first get diagnosed. Additionally, like I said, we offer the comfort and strength of being there and I've done that. And lastly, the part that I got involved in very heavily, and that's why I'm obviously here, is the educational aspect. The importance of educating you as to what you're running into in the fire service and what we should be looking for in the future. But more importantly, the importance of your annual physicals and the appropriate cancer screenings that are necessary for you to ultimately find out ahead of time. Number one, I know you guys aren't getting annual physicals through your department. You need to work between the department, your union, yourselves to try to resolve that issue. You have to get annual physicals. I mean, again, if you look at the IFF and WFI and that type of thing, you need to understand the importance of this. We had a gentleman on my department that skipped two physicals. No, I'm not going to go to the physical. I'm getting ready to retire. I'm not going to do it because if they catch something, I'll have to go to light duty, and you know that's a bummer, and then I'll have to go to a 40-hour work week, and this, that, and the other. All this time, everybody's trying to tell him, no, go get the physical, get the physical, get the physical. And he says, no, I'm not going to do it. And his wife is talking to him, hey, not only get the physical, but listen, you're 58 years old, it's time to get a colonoscopy. And the guy's going, no, I'm not going to have anybody touch my butt. I mean, he's a macho Hispanic guy in Miami. I mean, no, we're not going to do this. So the bottom, what happened is, the following year, just before he's getting ready to theoretically go into the drop, he comes up, he does his physical. The doctor looks at the report and said, we've got some serious blood work issues here. You will go get a colonoscopy. Bottom line to it, stage 4 colorectal cancer, inoperable. Yep, we can do something for you. We can give you some time of life. It might be quality, it might not, but we'll give you a couple years more that you can live through. Had he gone to his first physical and done the colonoscopy, he might well still be around. And I say that because we buried him 2 weeks ago. This is a reality. At 61 years of age, this guy didn't even make it to his retirement. Yes, 2 days ago, we just lost another member. We've lost 3 members to cancer on the job in the last 3 months. This is not unusual across the country. We're going to talk about some of your numbers here that we've talked about over the last couple of weeks or the last couple of days. So I can't stress to you guys strongly enough the importance of getting an annual physical, making sure, I mean, if the department's not going to pay for yours, then at least go get one and have some sort of baseline so that when you go for your next physical, and you want to, all right, you know, and they say, oops, you've got a problem here. You have something to say, I didn't have a problem here. I didn't have a problem the year before. I didn't have a problem a year before that. This is my problems. And we'll talk about more documentation in a little while also. So the program got started in 2003, like I said, with Mike DeBron. Mike DeBron was an LA County flight medic. And he walked into his doctor's office doing his annual physical out there in California, and the doctor said to him, "Mike, I get some bad news for you." He goes, "Okay." He wasn't thinking too much about it. He says, "You have stage 4 colorectal cancer, and you've got 1 to 3 years to live." He said he nearly dropped through the floor right there on the spot. He went back home and told his wife, and he had just gotten a brand new pair of boots, work boots that he had ordered online, he says, and he said, "Turn them back, I won't need them anymore." I mean, this was his thought process at the time. You got 1 to 3 years to live, you know, what's gonna happen to your wife, what's gonna happen to your kids? So this is one of those things where it affects more than just you as an individual. It's gonna affect a whole bunch of people, and including some of your coworkers. He started doing the same thing I did. Who's had this, whatever? And bottom line, what he found out was, well, Joe had cancer, so he went to go talk to Joe, and Joe says, "Well, that's not what I had, but Mike had that," and Mike says, "No, that's not what I had. Pete had this," and Pete, "Yep, that's what I had, and here's what I went through," and so on and so forth. So it's kind of a loose-lit organization, so to speak, and you know, if you start asking around in your department, you'll understand that some people are willing to talk about it, and some people will never talk about it. I mean, if you catch them to one side over drinks, they might talk to you about it, but otherwise it's not going to happen. So in 2004, he decided to join or start an organization. It's a nonprofit organization. And basically, it's as I described it already. 25 states are currently involved in the program. Since the FRI program in Chicago, where we released this white paper that I'll talk about in a little while, we've had about 8 more states get on board and express some interest in getting involved. All of us are volunteers. We don't get paid a dime. I'm not getting paid a dime, and I thank your union and you guys for at least putting me up in a hotel. Other than that, it's basically a volunteer organization. The organization is supported and endorsed by all these groups. The IFF, the IFC, the National Volunteer Fire Council, ISTA, Firehouse, all these. When I sat down in Chicago and talked to the Fire Chiefs Conference and gave them a very abbreviated version of what you're going to see here today, they were, for the most part, blown away. No one has ever really looked at numbers. Yeah, we know we have a cancer issue, and yeah, we got people dying of cancer here or there, but no one has ever really looked at how in-depth this is. So let's get into meat and potatoes of what's going on, cardiac versus cancer. And again, there's all sorts of stuff out there, and we're gonna talk about some of the numbers. What do we develop them? How do they develop them? What are the studies that were done? What were the results of these different types of studies? And what should we take away from all this? So how many of you have read this or heard this over the years of your career? Cardiac is the number one killer of firefighters. Well, the problem here is the definition of active on-duty firefighters. Line of duty death typically is the 24 hours you're on the job and the immediate 24 hours afterwards, right? I mean, you know, you go home, you have a heart attack, and you drop dead, and you've been on the job the shift before, you're probably going to be covered under that. Cancer is not that way in most cases. Cancer is not something that happens within 48 hours. This is not one of those issues. Young lady in my station that I worked with for almost 10 years developed acute myeloid leukemia. Had to go fly from Miami to Seattle to go get a bone marrow transplant. She was sick for almost 3 years. We carried her on the books. I mean, I worked swap time for her. We had other people come in and work in swap time for her so she could have her insurance, so that she could get her paycheck, so that if, you know, she came back on the job, at least she had a continuation of service. She passed away at the age of 48 years of age, okay? Not even considered a line of duty death. And this is one of those type of cancers that almost every department, when you go across the country, has on their presumption laws. I can go back as far as 1978, Saskatchewan, Canada, talked about cardiac being the number one killer of firefighters, all the way back then. But the more recent stuff, the NFPA, cardiac arrest is the top killer. In 2006, cardiac arrest is the leading cause. In 2007, WebMD says, yep, it's the biggest cause of on-duty death risks. Then you go into the later ones, 2009, the IFF, our own union, heart attack remains the biggest health risk. National Volunteer Fire Council, same thing. IAFC, as close as recently as this year, says it's still the number one cause of death in the fire service. Well, is it really? And if not, what's your reality? I'm going to turn the lights off for 1 second so you can see this video. It's a 30-second PSA, and I think it kind of hits home as to what we're talking about. How many people caught anything out of that? If I were to tell you, look to your left and look to the right, one of you will die of cancer, would you ever believe me? And yet the numbers that I'm going to show you are in fact basically that. More firefighters have been diagnosed in the last 2 years than in the previous 10 years before, combined. Okay? Now there's a number of different reasons for that. If you remember, or if you understand a couple things. Number one, departments have grown huge. My job, my department, I got on the seniority number, my seniority badge number was 424. Currently today it's in the 3200 range. That's how big my department has gotten over the last 30 something plus years. But if you also realize that if you go out on this fire today, you're cancer free today, right now, and you go out on a fire and you get exposed, and it's that one trigger point that you need. And you have to understand that we all probably have some form of cancer cells running around in our body. They're just kind of dormant, just like any cold cell or whatever else. It's kind of dormant until there's a trigger point for it. When that trigger point clicks in, things start going crazy. Your body starts growing cells and this and the other and starts taking off, and the abnormal cells keep growing. And unfortunately, unless you're doing testing on a regular basis, you may not see this. And you may not see it for 10, 15, 20 years. I mean, that's pretty typical for an average cancer. 15, 20 years before you even acknowledge it or they can even test for it. So, if we look at that, my generation right now is paying the price for our exposures back then. And Kate, and many of you guys have got the same issues going on, because maybe it was one of those early exposures when you first got on the job. So let's look at some of the cancer studies that are out there, and we'll go through these. I'm going to show them up here first so you can see them, and then we'll go through them in a minute. University of Cincinnati has basically got what we would consider the Bible study right now. The number one cancer study that everybody really looks up to right at this very moment. And Dr. Grace LeMasters, who I've had a chance to sit down and talk with on several occasions, basically took 32 different studies from around the country, put them together essentially in a blender, sliced, diced, and pulled them apart, put them back together, and came up with this whole meta-analysis and said, there's a number of issues that we need to face, and we'll discuss all this. Dr. Mott of the University of Miami in Florida basically said, look at his studies, and he did firefighters in Florida from 1981 through 1999. These are published in 2006, both of them. Dr. Letitia Davis did one for male Massachusetts firefighters, and you can see that one was published in 2008. And Dr. Thomas Hales from NIOSH is doing his study right now. Now those numbers and that whole study has not been officially released yet, but we'll talk about it because he sat and talked about some of the brief numbers at the Redmond Conference here in Denver this past Saturday. So I'll give you some previews, so to speak. But the University of Cincinnati, the Bible study. Because of your job that you've chosen to do, you're significantly more likely to develop these four types of cancers than workers in any other field. Testicular cancer, multiple myeloma, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and my personal favorite, prostate. These are the top four that you're going to develop potentially in because of your career path. Now, if you take a look at testicular cancer, you're twice as likely to develop testicular cancer than Joe citizen on the street. Multiple myeloma, half again. Non-Hodgkin's, half again. Prostate cancer, about a third more often. testicular cancer is a young guy's disease, typically in the 25 to 35 year range. In my department, it's a 45 to 50 year old guy's disease. It's just crazy stuff when you start looking at it. Additionally, the different other types of cancers that we are likely to get. Skin cancer, malignant melanoma, brain, rectum, buccal cavity, the whole area from the front of the mouth all the way down through the larynx. Stomach, colon, leukemia. Brain cancer, on this report, it's only got a 32% increase. Study after study is starting to show that brain cancer is the new lung cancer in the fire service. We all think of lung cancer. We all think of the guys that were on the job before me or before all of us that have died of lung cancer. Why? Because they weren't wearing their SCBAs and that type of thing. Lung cancer is not a big issue anymore. It's kind of dropped way off. But brain cancer is a big issue. This one here, this buccal cavity and pharynx in this whole area, the NIOSH study says that's one of the big cancers that they found. So a University of Miami study, 35,000 males, 2,000 females were looked at, 970 males were diagnosed, 52 females were actually diagnosed. So the percentages of increases of different types of cancers were this. Thyroid cancer, men were developing thyroid cancer in Florida at a 77% higher rate, almost twice the number. Testicular cancer, here we go again. Bladder cancer. Well, if you start thinking of the issues of getting some of these carcinogens into your body, you have to get rid of them somehow. And the obvious way we get rid of many things is through our bladder. So it's a giant filter. When we come down here to the Hodgkin's disease for females, the report readily admitted there's only 52 females. This percentage may be way exaggerated, but it is what it is right now. Thyroid cancer, women are going to have four times as much thyroid cancer as men. In general, it's the nature of the beast, unfortunately. Male Massachusetts firefighters. 2,100 members were found and diagnosed with cancers, and the increased diagnoses were brain cancer, almost twice the normal rate across the general population, Hodgkin's, colon, kidney, and bladder, just as you see it right there. This is one of the first studies that was really kicking in and pinning in on brain cancer as an issue. Seattle in 2008 sat down and said, you know what, with all these studies, let's find out what's going on within our own department. And what they basically wanted to know was who's had cancer and what's the prevalence of it. And so Blue Cross said, okay, well, of all the guys hired before 1977, there's 975 of them, 347 were diagnosed. 36% of their department has been diagnosed, 36% of these members have been diagnosed with some form of cancer. Now people say, well, skin cancer, everybody gets skin cancer. Well, that's true, and skin cancer is normally fairly easily treated if you're looking for it. 48-year-old male walked into a shower one morning, and his wife's watching him, and she goes, honey, you need to go see a doctor. There's something wrong with your back. And he goes, I don't see anything. She says, no, there's something on your back. I don't like the looks of it. Why don't you go get it checked? And he says, okay. A couple days later, hey, did you go call the doctor? No, I didn't. You know, I'm a little bit dizzy. She goes, no. I'm going to set up the appointment. Now, I've talked to her, so I know the story here. And he goes, whatever. So she makes the appointment. He walks in with her, or she walks in with him. And the doctor looks at it and goes, oops, this does not look real good. Okay, so what are we going to do? Well, we're going to cut it out and check it and send it off for biopsy and bring it back, and I'll let you know what happens. Calls him back a couple days later. We didn't get it all. Come back in. We didn't catch all the margins. Came back in, did it. They gave him some medications. They did some follow-up tests. 6 months later, he was dead of brain cancer because he missed that to begin with. So do not think for a moment that skin cancer is no big issue. Prostate cancer in men, it's pretty common. Basically, one out of every two or one out of every three typically is going to develop prostate cancer. The issue that you need to understand, though, is that in the fire service, we're getting a lot of these cancers earlier, and they're far more aggressive. When my doctor sat down with me, that was the answer. He says, listen, you're too young to have the type of prostate cancer that you have. this will kill you long before you should have died. He says, this is not something you can play around with. You have time. You can take 6 months and go on your cruise and do whatever you want. But by the end of this year, I want it taken care of. The NIOSH study is looking at the three departments, San Francisco, Chicago, and Philadelphia. They've actually looking at 35,000 firefighters that are active and or retired in these three departments. Why did they pick those? Because it was a good cross representation of across the country. I mean, you got Philadelphia in the east, you got Chicago in the center, you got San Francisco on the west coast. Why did they pick those, again, those departments? Because they're large departments. They could easily put them all together and collect the data very quickly. So anyway, so now they've taken the cause of the death and looked at them and said, okay, what are we looking at? And they went back and they went to a whole data collection. First of all, what they did is they took every member on the department from the time they got on the job to the time that that study is actually working on. Who's been on the job? Where did they work? What are their ages? How many fires were they on? Who were they on the calls with? What types of fires were they on? All these type of data has been brought in and they've kind of compiled a lot of information. As I said, right now, they've kind of come up with some of the preliminary numbers. It's not approved yet. They're not giving it out particularly well yet. It's not being disseminated across the country yet, but as at the Redmond, it was given out. So if we look at my department, and again, Miami-Dade Fire and Rescue being one of the largest departments in the country, we have 78 stations, we cover 1,800 square miles. We have a little over 2,000 uniformed personnel. If we look at our cancer issues, which I did, and I went back to our department and our health safety committee, which I sit on, as well as the, we talked to the insurance company, I said, I wanna know how many people have had cancer. Who, what type, male or female? Oh, by the way, while we're doing this, let's make sure that if they get diagnosed with multiple different types of cancers, that we only put down one, but we'll put down the worst one. And you guys are the people in charge of that, so you tell us which one's the worst one. And they immediately came back and said, well, we can't put this down because that's a HIPAA violation, we can't give you names. And I said, wrong. Cross the name out, give us a code that you understand, that we don't understand, but the rest of it you can put in. The department's so large that no one's gonna know, hey, a 52-year-old male, I mean, how many 52-year-old males are in the department? Could we track it? Maybe. So here's what we found. We went for 3 years, 2008, 2009, and 2010. Again, with the understanding that not once is any of these members got a second diagnosis. Not once. Every one of these diagnoses is one member of one diagnosis. Now, if we start looking at this closely, and we look at, first of all, the brain and nervous systems, 8 members in 3 years have been diagnosed with some sort of brain cancer issue. 8 members. We go down to the breast cancers, we have 10 women diagnosed with breast cancer. We only have 371 women on our job right now, but 10 of them were diagnosed with breast cancer. Cervix cancer, 22 women were diagnosed with cervix cancer. Now, what's interestingly enough, if you go to the CDC website, 8 women out of 100,000 in any year will be diagnosed with breast cancer, or I mean cervix cancer. We have all 8 of them, and we only have 371 women. When the doctors are starting to see this, they're going, there's something seriously wrong with this. Again, we go down through the melanomas and the non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Our studies are basically very similar. When I came down here, the testicular, again, the issue here is most of our guys that are diagnosed are between the age of 50 years of age, with only 2 exceptions. They were the younger guys. One of my EMS captains who I rode with on rescue for years and years, and our rescues are the same thing as ambulances with paramedics, but I rode with him for a number of years, and he called me up and he says, Keith, what the hell is going on? I said, hey, mate. Haven't talked to you in a long time. What do you mean? He goes, well, I went through my physical, number one. What a joke. He says, it's a pee test, and if you get a blood pressure, you're lucky. And he didn't get one. And he says, and a couple weeks later, I'm not feeling real well, and I go follow up with my own personal physician, and now I'm diagnosed with testicular cancer. Where the hell did this come from? Well, he had already known that I had been working on this for a number of years. And I said, well, Mike, unfortunately, welcome to the club, the one that no one wants to join. Number two, you're not alone in this. And he goes, what do you mean? I said, well, there's 12 other guys that have testicular cancer. He says, what? I said, Mike, there's 12 other guys. So we started talking about it. And again, he was 50 years of age when he was diagnosed with testicular cancer. 32% of the men and women on my job right now have cancer. One out of every three have cancer. If you were to go back to your insurance company, and I guess it's Kaiser up here or whatever, and ask them for this kind of information, you might be truly shocked by what you find. How many of you want to admit that you have some form of cancer? How many people do you know that have some form of cancer? And again, if I ask that question, do you know somebody on the department that's got cancer, almost all of you are going to raise your hand. But if I ask you how many of you have it, you're probably not going to do it. We don't talk about it, yet one out of every three members of my department right now has been diagnosed. And in fact, UnitedHealthcare looked at this and they go, this is crazy. We've never looked at this in this type of fashion, and we've got some issues to deal with, and you guys got some problems. We're three times more likely to develop cancer in our department than Joe Citizen out in Miami-Dade. Neoplasms, typically those things that could be benign, it could be precancerous, or it could in fact be a cancerous issue, again, are almost three times what the normal population has. And the leading edges, the leading causes are right there: head and neck, prostate, testicular, thyroid, melanoma, skin cancers, and the ambiguous, unspecified. Why is it unspecified? Because that's what the doctor put down on the report. So it is what it is. But when you start looking at the locations, you'll start, and we'll talk about it, why we're thinking some of this is happening, we'll understand it a little bit later. In 2011, again, you can kind of see it. Now on this slide, we've kind of put in the ages. Okay, and again, we've highlighted some of them. I mean, the women are, you know, they're being diagnosed 29 to 48 years of age with cervix cancer, with nine women in that 1 year. Okay, you come down here, you start looking at testicular cancer. Yeah, 32 years to 55 years. Okay, I mean, this is crazy stuff when you really kind of look at it. So, I mean, these are the issues that we're facing out there. 13% of the members in 2011 were diagnosed with cancer. In 2011, they changed their mind up a little bit more, and they said, you know what? Cancer is getting crazy. It's the number one cost for our health trust. Number one cost, 14% of all the costs for all the different types of treatments for any issue is due to cancer. Oh, by the way, we had an 8% increase in diagnosis for cancer last year over the year before, okay, in 2011. And if I show you some of the costs, three of the top 10 costs, claimants that cost us more than $50,000 a year to our health trust, $760,000 in 1 year, $992,000 in the second year, or total, sorry, in the total in the second year. Is this member is still alive on the job. $1 million we spent to put him alive, keep him alive. Do you think that's worth it? Oh, hell yes. To have more time with your family and your loved ones, is that worth it? I'd pay it in a heartbeat, okay? 4 years later, he's still on the job, but that's what it cost us to get him, keep him there. The next one down is the one I just told you about, that he died 2 weeks ago. $458,000 for 3.5 years of extra life. Was it worth it? He might have well have been here had he gone for his physical on a timely basis. Multiple myeloma. The other seven issues, pregnancy issues with women and men, low sperm counts, low egg counts, they're having difficulty conceiving. PAH is a major issue, it's an endocrine disruptor. Other issues, neonates. We have a lot of neonates that are born in our department. So those are high cost items. Okay, so we have 756 retired members on the job right now, or off the job right now, as of 2011. They're not all diagnosed with cancer, don't worry about that yet. 756 members are off the job. That's between the age of 55 or 25 years on the job, whichever comes first, and the age of 65 when they go into Medicare or Medicaid. 371 of them were diagnosed. That's one out of every two was diagnosed in 2011. one out of every two retirees. Cause of the death, we'll go try to go through this one fairly quickly, but basically, if we know what we're dying of, maybe we can figure out what we need to do differently. CDC, leading cause of death in 2010. These are the different types. 2,400,000 people died. 24% of them were for heart disease. The second cause was cancer. 23% of the general population died of cancer in 2010. The average age, by the way, was 78.7. 251 of our members have died for all the different types of issues. Cancer is the leading one. 96 members on our department have already died of cancer, accounting for 38% of all of our deaths. Cardiac is the next leading cause. Self-inflicted is the third leading cause of death on our department. Phoenix, when they wrote their little report and they said they lost, whoever it was, 5, 6, 7 members in a couple of years, we called them up and I said, listen, we'd like to sit on this white panel with you and discuss it because it's an issue across the country. We have not understood it. The average member died at the age of 63 from cancer. Hell, I'm almost 62. That doesn't bode well for me. Within the last 10 years, 2002 to 2012, 43% of the members died of cancer. Okay, 109 members died, 43% of them were due to cancer. So it's an increase. Self-inflicted suddenly became the second leading cause of death in our department. Why? For a number of different issues, cancer and cardiac. Three of these I personally knew and worked with for a number of years on my job. Okay, and this is a major issue. Two of them actually had this, one of them had this. Another one was just suffering from depression and took his own life. If you thought you were gonna make it to retirement, and this is what I tell my rookies, if you thought you were gonna make it to retirement, you might wanna reconsider. One third of our members that have passed away never made it to retirement. So when I teach my class right now, those people that have died, if you look at the death certificates only, and I teach this class, I say, look to your left and look to your right. One of you will never make it to the end of your career based upon those death certificates, and one of you will die of cancer. The third one, which one are you? Take a choice. These numbers have changed. We've lost three more members just this year alone to cancer. Just this year in the last 3 months. Within 10 years of retirement, 61% of our members have died of cancer. I mean, look at the difference. I mean, this is crazy when you start looking at it. I mean, we're talking about five times as many members are dying of cancer versus cardiac within the first 10 years of retirement. That retirement comes and goes just that quick. I'm 5 years into it already. Again, as I started at the very beginning, lung cancer is the leading cause, but those are the guys that came on the job before me, the smoke eaters, the guys that were 2 packs a day smokers that go, come on, rookie, you don't need that shit on your back, let's go. And they run into that farm, okay? Unknown cancers, brain cancer is the big one. Dr. Hales and Dr. Baxter, both, when I taught a class in New Orleans, and I gave them some of the statistics, this whole thing in New Orleans was an interagency board conference on the post overall environment in the fire service and what we could be doing differently and what we should be doing differently. And when I popped up with that number and it said 10%, they both came up to me after the class and said, are you sure? I said, Doc, I got the death certificates right. You know, I can show them to you. He goes, you realize that is like out of the line? I said, well, what do you mean? He says, less than 1% of the general population will ever die of brain cancer. Less than 1%, and you're showing that 10% of your cancer deaths are due to brain cancer? He says, that's crazy. Palm Beach County, one of my big supporters for the organization, they started getting interested. They looked at their members. Again, they have UnitedHealthcare. 1,500 members on the job, active and retired, of which 791 were diagnosed. Here's a preliminary report. 791 members have been diagnosed. 5,079 treatment options were given to those members. 53% of their department, I'm covered under UnitedHealthcare, have got some form of cancer going on. So people say, no, that's crazy. I mean, you know, this must be a Florida thing. There's no possible way that we're going through this. And I go to them, well, then let's look around some of the other places. And we go look at the CDC and the NFFF and NFPA and NIOSH and all these other organizations, and they all basically say the same thing. Yeah, there's a problem out there, but we don't know how to address it. And in fact, the NFPA states that they recognize that a comprehensive study of firefighter on-duty fatalities would include chronic illnesses such as cardiovascular disease and certain cancers that proved fatal and that arose from occupational factors. In practice, there is yet no mechanism for identifying on-duty fatalities that are due to illnesses that develop over long periods of time. This creates an incomplete picture when comparing occupational illnesses to other factors that cause the firefighter deaths. This is recognized as a gap, the size of which cannot be identified at this time because of the limitations in tracking the exposures of firefighters to toxic environments and the substances and the potential long-term effects of such exposures. Why do I read that to you? You guys have a cancer presumption law? Covers a lot of things. Has anybody claimed on it yet that you're aware of? I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to get a denial right off the bat. It's going to happen right off the bat. They got the numbers that they can sit there and can't, you know, cancel you out. Okay? They got the attorneys on their side and everything else. Do you file up personal exposure reports on yourselves? On every fire you go on, do you fill out some sort of form? Do you log it in a book? Do you have some sort of recording that says, I was on a fire, it was a car fire, this is the day and time I was on it, this is the crew members that I went with, you know, this was the exposures, it was black smoke, it was gray smoke, it was orange smoke, whatever it may have been. We went through 3 or 4 or 5 bottles. You know, it's just a room and contents type of fire. Do you fill out a report? And if not, how are you going to walk into whoever you have to claim this from, whether it be the state or your department or your city or whatever, how do you walk in and say, I've got cancer in this cancer presumption law and I want my benefits? They're going to look at you and go ahead and prove it now. And if you don't have that documentation behind you, you're SOL. Okay? At the Redmond, an example of that was the Phoenix department was given a presentation on their issues. I think he said the same thing. He had a guy walk in with 25 years on the job, and he says, hey, I've just been diagnosed with cancer. And the guy says, okay, you know, we go to the computer and print out your reports. And he says, well, I never filled out anything. He says, you didn't what? He says, I never filled out anything. I never thought about it. You know, we never think about getting cancer. And he goes, well, let me tell you this. Here's how it's going to have to go down then. He says, if you want your benefits, you're going to have to go back to every single station house that you ever worked in for the last 25 years of your job. You're going to have to go through those logbooks. You're going to have to find out where you worked, what kind of fires you went on, who your crew members were, what the time frames were, and you're going to have to document it from A to Z, from the start of your career to current times. He says, we may well be able to get that for you, but you have to go out and do it. Now this guy's going through chemo, he's going through radiation, he's sick as a dog, and he's having to drag his butt from one station to the other. 78 stations in my department, do you think I remember ever which stations I went to all the entire time of my career? There's no chance. Besides which, our logbooks have all disappeared. Okay? So the bottom line to this is, he did. He came back with 350 pages and he says, here it is. And he says, wow. He says, yeah, I think we can do this. And they went and argued and they won. But he had to go through that type of documentation to get it. If you guys aren't documenting, you've got a problem. Okay? If you have not seen Taking Action Against Cancer in the Fire Service, this is a white paper that our organization put together and it's been reviewed by people like Bobby Halton and Billy Goldfeder and some of the scientists and doctors and all the rest. We talk about exposure reports and how important that is. So let's get back to this. So you go to the IFF Line of Duty Death website, and basically this is a website, and you come over here, or wherever it is, Line of Duty Deaths, and you click it on. And what I did is, for arbitrary numbers, I put in male or female, and I put the age of 60, because in the state of Florida, we've kind of gone from the age of 55 to the age of 60 for retirement, thanks to our infamous Rick Scott, our governor. And basically we have now a 20-year time frame here that I clicked on. If you go down to the cancer, you click on cancer and it'll give you a drop-down box, click them all and print it off, see what it looks like. Go back and do the same thing for cardiac. Don't click them both on at the same time because you get a garbage on. But look what happens. In 2010, 13 members died of cardiac arrest, 28 died of cancer. Under the age of 55, these are line of duty deaths. 18 members total died of cardiac arrest and 30 died of cancer. Same thing for 2011, 15 of cardiac, 24 of cancer. In 2012, 24 of cardiac, 40 of cancer. Now I'm no math whiz, I'm no genius, but seems like cancer is killing more firefighters on the job, according to the IFF, than is cardiac. Well, here's the telling part of it. If we go back 20 years and we look at this, and we look at the age of 60, again, we keep that same number in place, 18 states don't have a cancer presumption law. The state of Florida is the largest one that has no cancer presumption law, and we have 35,000 firefighters in our state. So we don't report them in. But look what happened. In 1993 to 2003, 40 members died of cardiac, and only 31 died of cancer. Now, one too many of either or is too many. But cardiac certainly was killing more firefighters by that point in time. But in the last 10 years, look what's happened. In the last 10 years, it's totally flipped around. And not only is this a lot larger, this is four times what it was. This is 10 times higher than what this was. That's how much cancer has grown in the fire service. And yet we still ignore this. We still ignore this issue as being the primary cause of line of duty deaths. All right, so I've been teaching this class now. This is the fifth day. I'll have one more class after this. But you know, again, I bring this class to across the country. And people look at me and go, there is absolutely no freaking way that we have that many issues. So I've put a challenge out to every single class that's come through in the last week. Tell me who's passed away and what they've passed away of. So we started, the first 4 days was this, or the first 3 days was this. Yesterday, we added all this. Carl, cancer. Randy, of cancer. Steve, of suicide. Doug, cardiac. Tim Q, cardiac. Rick, a clotting issue. Jay, cancer. Mike, cancer. Joel, cancer on the job. Sherman, cancer on the job. Larry F, cancer on the job. Royce, cancer on the job. Mike, Perry, skin cancer. Jerry B, cardiac. Dennis R, suicide. Wharton, suicide. Steve Med, cardiac. Dan, someone with aneurysm. Bob, suicide. Aisha, something to do with Agent Orange. Paulson, suicide. Mike, my handwriting. Was a lung issue, but it wasn't technically a cancer issue. Ziggy, cancer of the brain, and Mike didn't couldn't remember. Anybody else want to add something? This is Denver, guys. This is what you guys have told me. You got a problem here? 10 members have died of cancer out of that group. 10 members have passed away of cancer. You guys got a problem also, and you just don't. The problem is, here's the issue when we look at line of duty deaths. Or death. You go to work one morning and your buddy's working next to you, and you know, we're all having jokes and this and the other, and the next morning, you know, everybody takes off and does their little thing with their families or whatever, and the next day you come on the job and Joe's no longer there. What the hell happened to Joe? He fell off a mountain. Motorcycle accident, car accident, cardiac arrest, whatever it may be. And we don't think about it, but it's suddenly like, bam, just that quick. Or a line of duty death, you know, fall through a roof, they decease, whatever it may be. Okay? These are the things that are sudden impact or have a big impact on our brain. We go, holy smokes, what just happened? Cancer and some of these other issues, they're long term. Okay? Get sick here, a couple months, a couple years, whatever it may be. We see them, yeah, they look worse, whatever. But we see them slowly deteriorate, and then they pass away. It's not such an insult. We don't recognize it as being the same type of issue. And yet, four of your people that you all acknowledged died on the job still working with cancer. How many members do you know right now that have cancer on the job? And I've been told of a couple at least, okay? You're a relatively large department, 900-something people. I will bet you that if you go back to Kaiser or whoever it is that's doing some of your physicals and said, or go to your insurance company and say, print it off. Just give us a list of who's had cancer. Don't give me names. Male, female, age, cancer, what type of cancer. You're going to be surprised. So, this is not going to be a hazmat class. I'm not going to get into it real crazy. But if you start thinking about what are our causes and what are our issues, maybe we can start doing things a little bit differently about what we get ourselves involved into. So we look at this car fire and we say it's only a little car fire, and how many of us have rolled up on one of these things and we never put on our Scott Pack or MSA or whatever it is, and it's only a little car fire and you do one of these things as you're walking around. Yet all the stuff that's coming out of here that we'll talk about is crazy, and it's basically confined. I mean, we're talking about benzenes, we're talking about formaldehydes, we're talking about styrenes, you know, we're talking about all sorts of stuff. All of it's real bad for you. What's the difference on that kind of fire? Well, that's probably going to be more of a long distance type of fire, probably. Okay? But again, whatever we see there, you know, we certainly don't want to be walking around into it, but at some point in time, we're probably going to be involved, wind shift, whatever, you're stuck. And then we've got this idiot. And I say that because what's the difference in the smoke between this, this, and this? There's not a lot of smoke except on that side. There's a ton of smoke here, and there's very little smoke here. Yet this fire can be just as deadly, if not more so, than the other two. And if you're going to depend upon the amount of smoke or the color of smoke as being an indicator of what the problem is, then you guys need to start thinking differently. You need to go talk to that hazmat team that you guys have got. Okay? Because we rolled up on one of these things. I was a driver on the aerial. First in due on a shopping center fire. Well, it turned out to be this thing behind the shopping center. As we roll around the corner, and my guys are geared up because we were a minute and a half out. It was the shopping center right behind our station. We rolled around, we seen this smoke, and we're going, oh, smokes, what's this? Next thing we know, I'm looking at this thing as we're pulling up to it, and there's a huge explosion, great big cloud, and suddenly flames, and I thought, what just blew up in this thing? Well, the evolution, dumped the 2.5 inch over the edge, crank on the valve and fill it up and let it flood over and see what's going on and put it out. Well, that ultimately works. And when we start digging around and say, what the heck just blew up? Somebody looked like they dumped their hardware store in the back dumpster. Now, the dumpster was actually behind a grocery store. Shouldn't have been any of the type of chemicals that we found in that dumpster fire. Yet we see this all the time, and you guys probably do too. Somebody gets ready to go move, and the mover company says, hey, we're not taking this with us. You can't load this on our truck. Government regulations, none of this. And the new buyer of the home says, I don't want it. Get rid of it. And so what do? They load it in the car, and they go to the nearest dumpster, and they toss it in there. I don't care where it's at. I mean, that's the fact of life. So we need to understand that all smokes hazardous are potentially lethal at high enough concentrations. And you don't have to have a lot of smoke to have a lethal concentration. Here we are rolling in on this fire. Single story, family, could be two story, I don't know, basement. They might have an attic in it. We call it single story in Miami-Dade. But anyway, here's the garage. Okay, there's the garage area. So again, is this a simple house fire or more of a complex hazmat incident? And if we start understanding that, A, number one, this is in the garage, so what do we store in the garage? Power tools, chemicals, everything that we don't want in the house and exposing our family to. It's all in the garage, then this becomes more of a hazmat incident. The fires that you fight today are different from the fires that I got on when I got on the job. Okay? When I got on the job, it was called the legacy fire. I mean, it was a wood house, wood furniture, you know, wool and natural fibers and that type of stuff. You look around this room, and there's plastic synthetics everywhere. So if that's the case, if it's a hazmat incident, which gear should we be wearing? And we would all say if it's a known hazmat, we're going to be wearing this stuff. But it's a fire, so we're going to go over here to this. I mean, we try to put this on. This is impervious to the chemicals and it's, you know, gases and all the rest. This is great stuff for a hazmat. This not so much. The bunker gear breathes. As you move around, it breathes. It's a tight synthet or tight material, but as you move around, studies are showing that there's a bellows effect. It moves in and out, it breathes. So you've got air and stuff flowing up through the bottom, through the sleeves, through the collar area, all these type of areas that you think are tightly sealed. Yeah, they're pretty good for the heat, but not for the gases and the carcinogens and everything else that we're facing. So let's look at some of the chemicals that we find during firefighting. In the IARC, which is probably considered the premier organization on studying cancer across the world, basically classifies a bunch of different cancers and the types of issues that you may face with it. So on the left-hand side, you see all the different types of cancer issues, bladder, brain, so on and so forth. On the right-hand side, we have all the different types of chemicals that we face on a regular basis. By the way, if you start looking through here, like formaldehyde is here for brain cancer, formaldehyde is here for colon cancer, and formaldehyde is down here for leukemia. Same thing with some of these others. I mean, you know, you look at it and you go benzene down here for leukemia and benzene's up here for bladder. It's also down here for the lymphatic. Similar types of cancers, similar types of exposures can cause different types of cancers. Well, people say, well, how do I know which kind of cancer I might get? Well, that's like saying when you walk into a doctor's office and everybody's sick in there and your whole crew goes in to go treat somebody, one of you comes down with a minor cold, one of you comes down with sniffles, one of you goes to the hospital because you got pneumonia, and the other one's not affected at all. Why? Because our bodies adapt and overcome things differently. Same thing happens here with the cancer issues. But do you want to take the chances? Go on the other side, lung cancer, mesothelioma, nasal cavity sinus, pharynx, skin, soft tissue. Mesothelioma, the interesting part of this study from Dr. Hales from NIOSH said that that was one of the big cancers between San Francisco, Philadelphia, and Chicago. That was like one of the premier cancers. Well, we go, mesothelioma, I mean, I'm going, I've never thought about it in that fashion because we don't have asbestos in Florida for the most part. I mean, our buildings aren't that old. So number two, I'm going, why? And then you start talking to him, he goes, they're all old departments. These buildings have been around for hundreds of years. Asbestos was used a lot back then. And so when they start pulling down the ceilings. So we all understand that. But look at some of the other issues. This one was recently added to the lung side. We'll talk about it, but diesel exhaust is a known carcinogen. So the hazmat guy with the meter says, you guys do realize the smoke is just as dangerous as the fire, right? As they're out there sniffing it all up. Your department has a policy apparently in place that says you test for CO and you test for HCN. It also has the policy that says you're gonna wear your SCBA 24, you know, during overhaul and all the rest. I've got a copy of it here. But what are you testing the CO and HCN for? Are we testing to decide that the air is clear and we're gonna take our mask off? And many departments do that. And if that's the case, then you're making a very bad mistake. I understand why that class is taught by another organization. CO and HCN are both hypoxic to the heart. So it's a huge issue when you start looking and comparing those two and the cardiac line of duty deaths and those type of issues as to why we might test for it. But again, if you were sitting in on the interagency board conference in New Orleans, three of the top scientists in the country, and this conference was White House people, Department of Defense, Department of Health, some of the top scientists, some of the top doctors, and I was the little peon coming in and making a presentation. Because NIOSH, Bill Haskell, heard my presentation. We talked across at the Philly conference, and he says, I want you to come and make a presentation there. All three scientists said the same thing. Under no condition should you be monitoring for anything to make a determination to take your mask off. no condition for anything should you be taking your mask off from the time you arrive on that fire to the time you finish overhaul and get mounting back on your rigs. The exception is if you're in a cold zone and you're going through rehab or you're changing your bottle out. That's the only exceptions. If you're on the firefight, or if you're doing overhaul, or if you're in a warm zone, and we have, how many of us classify a warm zone in a fire, mask on, breathing off of it. This is something that we're now recognizing as an issue. Absorption is becoming another big issue, but we need to understand that that overhaul environment is probably far more dangerous to us than that firefight was. Back to the University of Cincinnati, benzene, diesel engine exhaust, chloroform, soot, styrene, and formaldehyde are the big leaders, okay? I've walked around some of your stations recently. I don't want to throw anybody in the bus, but the diesel exhaust system is better than what we have, but when you pull a truck in and the hose is kinked, it's not going to suck anything out. And if I understand the system correctly, when you push that door and the doors open up, that fan kicks on for 25 or 30 seconds. At 3 o'clock in the morning, when the guy's in the bathroom taking the whiz to go before he gets on that truck to go out on the roll, how long is that gonna take? 35, 40 seconds? So now you roll that truck out, that fan's already kicked off. Disconnects, where's that exhaust gone? It's staying right in your station. It's not a great system, it's better than what we have in my department, I'll grant you that. But you guys need to try to see if we can work on something a little different there. Many of the chemicals can be inhaled, ingested, injected, as well as absorbed. Okay, we all know about inhalation. Injected, no one ever thinks about it. You step on a nail, you see them been in a burning building or whatever, it's got carcinogens and so on and so forth, or you grab someone, cuts you, whatever, you may get it through your glove. Ingested. Ingested is not normally discussed, but it's something we keep talking about. Cool down phase, chief says, go over and cool down. You go over the rehab trailer or whatever. I don't know what you guys have got, but you go grab a banana and an apple, a Gatorade, whatever, and you start drinking. Did you wash your hands first? If not, all that stuff is coming off and it's going in your digestive system. Absorption. Absorption is becoming the new major issue in the fire service. This is where we're going to start getting into. What did I just do? Wrong button. Okay, so let's talk about CO. And again, it is a byproduct of all fires and it is considered one of the most hazardous that we find in any fire. Consequently, that's one of the reasons why we monitor for it. But there's absolutely no correlation between what the smoke is and the amount of CO. You could have a lot of smoke and very little CO, and it could be vice versa. So do not look at smoke and say, oh, no smoke, no CO. Cyanide is the other big issue, and that's again why we do CO and HCN. Encountered far more often than we thought. It's far more potent and faster acting. Oh, by the way, the Nazis used it to kill a whole bunch of people in World War II, and we still use them in the exterminate in our prisons to kill people with. It's 35 times more toxic than CO. So if you're monitoring for HCN, you're good, but you're then missing CO and vice versa. Benzene, amongst the 20 most widely used chemicals in the United States, and it's also considered one of the most dangerous. Everything, almost everything that is manufactured has benzene, gasoline, petroleum products involved in the manufacturing of it. Almost everything. I mean, you look at this carpet, you look at the desk, you look at the chairs, all this type of stuff, the screens over there, the computers up here. Once it starts off-gassing, once it starts burning, whatever, it's gonna go off-gas this stuff. It's considered the second most commonly found organic smoke we find in the smoke. It's also classified as a known human carcinogen, okay? Causing AML, anemia, and susceptibility to clotting disorders. In the last week, I've had 4 of your members come up to me and say, this is an issue that I've got going on. Is this collected? I can't tell you. I'm not a doctor, I'm not a scientist. I've never heard of this before, and yet 4 of your members came up to me this week. I got clotting disorders going on my legs and this and the other. Is this an issue? It's an issue, obviously, because you've got it going on. Formaldehyde, a known human carcinogen. There's all the different types of cancers that causes it, and there's the different byproducts, of, you know, where it comes from. So you have a quick idea of, look around the room. Formaldehyde is going to be released, and it is a known human carcinogen. Vinyl chloride, again, a known carcinogen. Car fires, automobile upholstery, mats, everything inside the house. It's all got vinyl chloride. I mean, you start thinking about your PVC piping and so on and so forth. Additionally, there's a whole bunch more of chemicals and gases out there that are undetectable without monitors and far more dangerous than both CO and HCN. So if we're using just those two as a measuring device, we'll never catch all the other ones. And that was what was being stressed over and over again at that New Orleans conference. Under no conditions should we be using these two as the indicator for its safe environment. And depending upon the air currents, obviously it extends way beyond necessarily the actual fire itself. I mean, if you go back to that one big warehouse fire that we showed at the very beginning, I mean, you can see that environment goes way up. That car fire, maybe not this quite so far, but what they're getting at is we need to start thinking of a hot zone, the fire, a warm zone where we're looking at possible gas mixes off, and then the cool zone or cold zone where you're gonna do your rehab and clean up and such. Styrene, although styrene is not a carcinogen, exposure to styrene can affect your CNS system and does in fact cause Parkinson's disease, according to this study. Why do I bring it in then? Well, because firefighters, according to the study, are 10 times more likely to develop Parkinson's disease than the general population. Something to consider about. I got three guys in my department right now, plus one from another department that I play golf with, that all have this. Soot. We all like to look dirty. We like to look have that salty look on us. We like to be the macho gladiators. And yet soot is considered a group one carcinogen. All that black stuff that we get on our gear and our faces and our hands all rest gets sucked right into our body as the pores open up because we're hot, sweaty, and everything goes on and gets sucked right in. And in fact, Dr. Grace LeMaster said that many firefighters told her that they come back from a fire, they're hot, they're sweaty, but yet they're so freaking tired from that firefight at 3, 4, 5 o'clock in the morning that they just jump right back into bed. Been there, done that a number of years when I got on. We need to start thinking about deconning our bodies. We have to start thinking about it. This is a big issue now. We have to start thinking of it, and I'll show you the reasoning and justifications for it. But they're saying right now, we should be taking baby wipes after the fire's out, when we're starting to do decon, gross decon of our gear. We should take baby wipes and wipe our face and our neck and on our hands and wherever else we can get to easily enough and get off the major crud that we have all over us. Then go back to the station and take a shower. Okay? This is a culture change, folks. This is not something we've ever gotten into. Oh, let's get out of this, you know, let's put gear back together so we can go grab the next fire. We need to start a whole new culture change. You go on a fire, you break down, you decon, take a shower, change your clothes, somebody else will grab the next fire. Now, will it work? We have to make that determination, but I can assure you that in our rescue ambulance units, we roll in on a blood and guts shooting, stabbing scene, and there's body fluids all over the back of that truck. Guess what? That truck's out of service. Until we go back to the station, decon that truck, take a shower, change our uniforms out, and then we go back in service. And we're firefighter paramedics, okay? We go on fires just like everybody else. We're a RIT team, we could be a second unit in, okay? We can actually grab a hose and work with the next hose, the first engine in. We could be assigned to go open a roof or whatever. We can do all of that stuff. But we will not go on another call until we've actually deconned ourselves. And fire service needs to make that change. Skin absorption. In 2009, this has changed. 2009, they didn't know really about skin absorption. What type of chemicals were absorbed? What was easily absorbed? What wasn't easily absorbed? But they did know in studies that there was an absorption issue with our bodies. We are three times more likely to absorb through our groin area than anywhere else in our body. men or women, makes not one bit of difference. So let's go back to one of those first slides where we talk about testicular cancer and prostate cancer and cervix cancers, and we start thinking about what goes on. So here we are pulling our boots up and pulling our pants on, and we're going in on a firefight, and we're getting all hot and sweaty, and those pores open up and continue to open up, being facetious, but all those chemicals and everything else are just rushing right into that opening in the skin. Jaw angle. What was interesting is the conference that Dr. Prezant was at from FDNY, we were talking about this. We're almost twice again likely to develop any type of issues around our jaw. Thyroid cancer. He has a huge issue of thyroid cancer on his department. We started talking to him and I said, how many of those guys get out of that fire, you go to the cool rehab, they've taken off everything except that hood, and that hood just sits around your neck. And it's like a giant sponge, it just sucks everything in, and sitting right here is your hot and sweaty. And he goes, I said, how many guys ever clean that? And he started thinking about it, he said, my guys probably never do. He says, I don't think I've ever seen them turn that in to get clean. He says, that's something we're gonna change as soon as I get back. And my department's very similar. We turn in our bunker pants and our bunker, jacket, but we won't turn on our hood, we don't turn on our gloves, and we certainly don't turn on our helmet, which brings me to the next thing, the forehead and scalp. 34 years on the job, I never once cleaned my helmet. It's a badge of honor, it's our lid, we will not clean our helmet, it looks salty, we are one working son of a gun on a firefight when we carry that in. And yet, how many different types of fires have we gone on and that chemicals are embedded in that sweatband? Three guys in the last couple days have told me that they've had skin cancer across their forehead, and that sweatband just sits right there. Coincidental? I don't know, guys. I can't tell you that the firefight is your cause of cancer. I'm not here to tell you that. But when you start looking at the numbers for the general population, and you look at the fire numbers for cancer, we're far ahead of what the general population is. So there's something going on here. Again, the back, the forearm, and all the rest. For every 5-degree increase in your skin temperature, you have a 400%, four times increase in absorption rates. Every 5 degrees, you sit in this room and they turn up the air conditioner, 5 degrees, you get 5 degrees warmer, you got four times more likelihood of absorbing something through your skin. That's what's going on. That's the big issue that we're facing. The PPE didn't do a very good job in protecting us in the past. Well, that's for sure, because that's the gear that I came on with. Mine was silver, but you got these 3/4 length jackets and the hip boots and the helmets that are up there with no ear flaps, they're plastic, they're fiberglass. Mine was fiberglass. Sometimes you had SCBA, sometimes you didn't. When I first came on, we were just converting into it. But like I said, the officer says, rookie, leave that there, that's not for you. And so this gas and all the rest just went up through our gear. And we're paying the price for it now, folks. You guys got better gear. That's somewhat of the evolution. I mean, you look at it, the gear's better, it fits better, it works better. It's much better for as far as heat goes. I mean, I can tell you the number of times I burned my ears going in on a fire with that old gear. Well, now you've got the Nomex hood, and you've got the ear flaps and all the rest. But it does not protect us well against chemicals and gases. Does not. That truck is about ready to run over a whole bunch of people, whether you know it or not. And it's not going to stop until we make some changes. So let's talk about some safe work habits and what we should be doing differently, possibly. And this is definitely going to require changes in behaviors, attitudes, and cultures. The problem with some of this is we like the departments. We grew up. There's habits. There's customs that we go through. And a culture change typically takes one entire generation. Okay, one entire generation. So now you're facing a situation where you're writing off a generation of firefighters for what? Probie guy. First day on the job. That's his job. Hold that target while I'm aiming at it. And that's not so funny, but we laugh about it. This is the first day for the bomb technician. Notice he's out there kind of playing with some bomb, and Look at the idiot back here with a bag that's about ready to pop it behind his head. I'll bet that gets a rise out of him real quick. That's your new ladder truck. The chief just ordered it for you. It'll be here next week. Oh, I'm sorry, chief. It's a little difficult to get around, but they'll make it quick. And how about this poor idiot? He's standing using an electric drill on an aluminum ladder in his bare feet in the hotel pool. And we go, excuse me, what? That's ingenuity, if you ask me. I mean, but how safe is that? It doesn't look real safe to me. And I hope the guy that was driving this understood that that bomb was diffused. It wasn't a live bomb as it went off. So we laugh about these things, and we look at these guys, and they say, how stupid are these guys? I mean, you know, that's dumb. And then we have this. The guys are sitting up here, and they're not gonna, or any SCBA, and they're either spraying water in their cock loft, or the roof trusses, or floor trusses, whatever it is. And you can see at the bottom, there's all sorts of smoke. Same thing with these guys. And this is a much newer crew. And if you look at this, and I, you know, the picture without the lights on, this guy over here is not wearing a mask. This one hasn't been wearing a mask. And this guy certainly has been wearing a mask, but he did wipe his face, so you can see how clean and how dirty his face is. This guy over here was probably wishing that he was wearing a mask.
Hi, Chief.
Bye, Chief.
I'm just monitoring.
Okay. So you look at these guys, and the guys down here aren't even wearing any kind of PPE. I mean, they may be volunteers, whatever, but they've got absolutely nothing on. 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the morning, the chief's gone. He's, now you're going to roll on this car fire. It's only a little car fire. No SCBA, the chief's not around. We're good. Well, suddenly you got to walk around and do that 360, and you're trying not to breathe. There was a study done back in 2001 about SCBA and PPE usage. And it basically stated that one study found that firefighters only used a protective breathing apparatus about 50% of the time at structural fires and 6% of the time for all fires. Well, I look at that picture and I look at that study, and first of all, I go, that's probably not, for the most part, metropolitan department. I mean, I would like to think that for the most part, we're far better than this. And the Phoenix study that I'll show you in a minute will be that. But then you come over here, and again, you can't see this real well because of the lights, but the guy over here has got his SCBA mask hanging in front of him. This guy's got a bottle on. I can't tell if he's wearing his mask. This guy's got his mask on in front of him, hanging in front of him, and this guy's got his mask on in front of him. Now, the chief came back, but I'll throw him under the bus anyway. What does a white helmet mean? And why is it the bottom line to it? Because he hasn't told his guys here to mask up. Oh, and by the way, why is it that he's even standing here in the middle without a bottle and mask on of his own? I mean, he's right there in the middle of smoke. So we need to understand that there's got to be a major culture change. There's got to be an understanding that lead by example and make sure that your guys are doing what they're supposed to be doing. 2007, Phoenix, as you all know, is a pretty aggressive and progressive department. They took a quick look, and they were doing pretty good on their fires. And I would say that, you know, your department's probably along like this. Our department's probably pretty similar. 86% of the time, we're wearing it for car fires, 98% of the time for building and commercial fires, and 52% of the time for the trash fires. I would say that's probably pretty typical. But here's the problem. You get into the overhaul environment, and suddenly everything goes out the window. Only 14% of the guys are wearing their SCBA during overhaul. 8% or 7% say never, which means it's loser. But the bottom one is the one that concerns me. The 80% of the guys that aren't deciding whether they're going to wear it or not, or when or how, oh, it's a little bit of smoke, it's no big deal, or it's, you know, I don't smell anything. Well, you don't have to smell some of the stuff for it to be bad. The big reason you wear this is to protect yourself. SCBA provides you a protection factor. The unfortunate part is we reserve it for wearing for active firefighting only. I'm going to guess that this guy was real happy that he was wearing his SCBA when that roof came down on top of him. Because all this stuff he would have been sucking into his lungs at that point in time. Okay? I'm sure he was happy with that. I can stand here and talk about cancer till I'm blue in the face, just like Paul Combs put here. But until you guys make that conscious decision that you're going to change things for yourself, and you may try to start it at the bottom or work up, or the chief may ultimately say, you know, we're going to make some changes. This policy and procedure from Denver on your SCBA usage is a very good start on that, okay? But some of these other issues need to be addressed still. Are your fire stations killing you? Are you killing yourselves? Here are some of the issues that we need to face in the future. NFPA guidelines. NFPA 1500 has to do with state fire station facilities. What is good, what is bad, so on and so forth. And 1851 has to do with care of PPE gear. So this is the newest and latest version of 1500, the 2013 edition of it. Fire station facilities. I already know the answer. What stations don't have smoke detectors? You're on camera, you want to say it? Okay. Smoke detectors. I can assure you that my department doesn't have them in most of the department, in most of the stations either. Why? Why don't we have smoke detectors in our own stations? We tell our citizens, get a smoke detector, change the batteries twice a year, all that type of stuff, and yet we don't put them in our own stations? What is wrong with us? Basically, if you have a sprinkler system in your station, then you can get by with smoke detectors just in the sleeping areas. Otherwise, you have to have them in the entire area, including basements. The only basements we have in Florida are called swimming pools. Okay? We don't have a basement. Smoke detectors activate, general activation alarms, you go out through the entire building. Well, that's common sense. So if you don't have smoke detectors, I'll bet you don't have carbon monoxide detectors. And yet that diesel truck is emitting carbon monoxide. Your jaws are emitting carbon monoxide. Your generators are emitting carbon monoxide. I've been in through some of your stations. Kitchens are open to the bay areas. Bedrooms are open to bay areas. Office, front offices are open to bay areas. You guys are breathing this stuff over and over again. Okay? They also state you're not supposed to be taking your gear into the living and sleeping quarters. Why? Because you're going to contaminate things. You're not supposed to have carpet in the living and sleeping areas. Why? Because you're dragging everything in and it's staying on the carpet. The fire department shall prevent exposure of firefighters and contamination of living and sleeping areas to exhaust emissions. You guys have got those hoses. They're better than what we have. But if they're only running for 25 or 30 seconds, you're not going to get the exhaust out of the station. It's going to get halfway up the pipe if you get out the door just that quick, and then the exhaust fan kicks off. That's got to change. You're supposed to have, according to the companies that design these things, Plymouth, Magna Grip, and Niederman are the three big companies. You're supposed to have a total air exchange within the bays at least, at the very least, every 10 minutes. That means every bit of that air is supposed to be changed out within every 10 minutes. That's six changes an hour. Think you can pull it off? I know our department can't. I'm not going to go through all that, but that's the background for the NIOSH, the NFPA. As far as gases, if you read it through it, there's all the stuff that we've kind of talked about. NTP, EPA, and NIOSH all say the same thing. Diesel exhaust is potentially dangerous, a carcinogen. But the IARC trumped it in June of last year and basically said, not only is it dangerous, but it's a known human carcinogen, one of the classes, it's the worst of the worst, okay? It is one of the worst cancers that we can face, or carcinogens that we can face. And yet we face it every single day. Whether you run another fire in your entire career or not, that's what you're facing. So in Lynn, 3 o'clock in the morning, the guy runs in the bathroom, and the truck's running up, and you pull away, and the door slams shut. And where's that diesel exhaust? Right in that truck stall, rolling back into the kitchen, the bathrooms, and sleeping quarters and all the rest. Diesel exhaust has 100 different chemicals that when combined equal 10,000 different types of chemicals, the vast majority of which are cancer-causing or suspected carcinogens. Needs to be addressed. PAHs is a big issue. When we talk about the PAHs, again, it's an endocrine disruptor. It has some connection between the fertility of men and women and their babies, okay, and their ability to conceive. Again, diesel exhaust, There's all the different types of chemicals. We've already discussed these, how bad these are. So FEMA in 97 wrote this whole great big book on how to design a fire station, what you should be doing, what we're looking for. Back in 97, okay? And they looked at a study that was commissioned by the IF in 85 of the exhaust emissions and said, yep, that's a major source for us. What's left in the station after we pull out is a major issue for what we're exposed to. Here's why I throw my department under the bus. That's our exhaust system right there, folks. There's our diesel stack for the engine. All this gray stuff that you see up here, this dark black stuff, oh yeah, that's the diesel exhaust. There's a doorway to the sleeping quarters for our engine crew. And up here at the other arrow is the entrance to the front office, the kitchen, and the living room. So you get a call out, and the guys are running out, the driver's already in the truck and started up, and what goes up has to come down and get sucked right on into the station. Okay, and we just spread it around. The other side's just as bad. This is the rescue side, the ambulance side. And again, you can't see the pictures very well, but the bottom line to it is, we paint our walls gray so you don't see the dark black for the diesel exhaust. Yet, that's where the diesel exhaust is. And that's the entrance to their sleeping quarters. Rescue 9, same issue. Over there, here, is where the exhaust is. The doorway leading to the sleeping quarters. And oh, by that way, you don't see it very well, but that other arrow is pointing to the air intake for the air conditioner system. So that thing just drives right past that air conditioner system day in and day out. Don't think this is a problem? What this shows is an air conditioning duct taken out of a station over on Miami Beach. This was taken out after they started putting in the source capture from Plimavent, and Plimavent kind of got up and said, hey, you got a problem up here. That's the color the air conditioning should look like, right over there, that orangish color. All that other black stuff that's around it, tested by an independent lab, it's diesel exhaust. And all of the other stuff, that white stuff, that's mold that's eating it. Oh, by the way, this air conditioning duct came out of a fire station that was only 3 years old. 3 years old, folks. You want to go look into your stations? How old is the oldest station? Might be a little scary. That doesn't qualify as an exhaust emission, okay? Yet that's right behind engine 5. That's what we installed there, the department installed, so that we could have something to get rid of. That doesn't qualify for it. Neither does that. Just because it says no running engine doesn't mean that we're going to push our trucks in and out. That doesn't qualify either. This is what a good system looks like. And again, yeah, it says Plimavent on it. Go buy Niederman or Magnet Grip. I don't care. But notice the difference between this system and the systems you guys have got. This system hooks up to the truck. It's hanging up here. As the truck pulls out, it runs along the end. It hits the end of it. The magnet kicks it off. Depending upon the system you buy, it'll either stay out here at the end so that when you back in, the guys can grab it and hook into it. Or if you've got a drive-through station, it'll go to the front, and as you leave and the door shut down, it comes all the way to the back. But you also have to have this thing running for a while. And there should be auxiliary air intakes and air exhausts to get rid of the residual. Yeah, it gets out about 98%. But you still want to have some airflow going on. So it's got to happen for a while. What's wrong with this picture? It's a great system, but it's not hooked up. What the hell is a good system if you don't hook it up? And this is where our department said to us, well, you guys aren't going to hook up to this thing, so why should we buy it? Well, excuse me, chief, but you're a chief and I'm a driver, and if I don't hook up to the truck, excuse my French, but my ass should be written up. Easy. We were trying to be kinder, gentler. Our doorways. We need to start thinking about trying to keep the gases and toxins out of our living and sleeping quarters. So they said positive pressure, doorways, double doors. When you walk through the first door, it breathes, the air blows, and it continues blowing out, and you walk through another door. You guys use it up here all the time. You don't think about it, but you keep the heat into your buildings. Why? Because you got double doors in the wintertime. Okay, you open one door, you open the next door, keeps the heat in for the most part. Same thing. There's departments out there right now that if you go to them, not only do they have these things, but they also say, your gear's not coming in here, and oh, by the way, your station boots, your work boots that you're wearing right now, you'll leave them at the doorway. You'll swap over into a flip-flop or a sneaker to work on the inside, to come out to the inside of the station. They're trying to keep these things that clean, okay? They recognize the issues. No bunker gear should be stored on the apparatus bay floors. We should not be doing this, again, for the exposure reasons. Instead, according to FEMA, we're supposed to have specialized rooms for storage of our gear, double doors or single doors, it doesn't make any difference, but doors that are sealed with a positive pressure and it's forcing it outside, away from the from everybody. This is what we normally consider a bad example. You look at the bunker gear, you're standing in the truck stall bay area. That's the bunker gear room with no doors, and if you don't see it, on the back side there is an exhaust fan. So we just suck everything right out past us. It's not my department, it's another one. That's a nice looking example. Okay, everybody hangs their gear up nice and neat and all the rest. But what's missing out of that picture? The trucks. The trucks that they're backing in and out between them, as you can see. Well, the problem with this is there's no exhaust system in this. So every day that you're not in that station and your gear's laying on the floor, that diesel exhaust is pumping all over your bunker gear, all over your pants. And so you're going in the next day and you're pulling your pants on because you're on a firefight or whatever, and that diesel exhaust is now up against the boys and whatever. We need to think differently about how we do these things. That's one of my departments, that's one of my newer stations. And again, the same issue. The back, the bay door at the back is at the back. This is what we call our exhaust system. It's one set of jalousie windows, no fans, no exhaust, no nothing in this station. That's the only way we get any ventilation into this room. And we just suck it right down through here. This is one of our older stations. Again, there's the intake, there's the exhaust, and the prevailing breezes come this way. So it's intake exhaust over the hazmat, intake exhaust over the hazmat, round and round and round we go. When I was teaching in mid-Florida, Kissimmee, I went to the stations and I took a picture of this. And the next day the chief happened to walk in and sit in on the class and he looked at it and he says, excuse me, yes sir, I'm on one of my trucks. And I said, does it look like one of your trucks, sir? He says, it does. I said, it could well be. I wouldn't want to throw you definitely under the bus, but why? What's the problem? He says, that's filtered water. I said, well, great, that's filtered water, but the ice cubes have got diesel exhaust all over them. I said, those things aren't sealed, okay? So that truck that runs in and out of there gets diesel exhaust. Within a week, it got moved. NFPA 1851 has to do with cleaning of your gear. How often is your gear cleaned? How often do you turn your gear to get it cleaned? How often does the department make you to do it? Every use and or soiling. Now you guys use your gear up here for a different reason. You use it to stay warm in the wintertime. I understand that. In Florida, we would never put on our bunker gear unless we needed it, okay? But soiling. Every time you go out on a firefight, if you put on your bottle, you need to think about, why do you put on that bottle? It was a hazardous environment. If it's a hazardous environment, then it was dirty. It needs to get clean. You've been exposed to something. You need to start thinking differently about it. I'm not saying it has to go through the whole big rigmarole of taking it apart and sticking in a washer machine. I'm just saying at the very least, start considering gross decon. NFPA 1851 says it shouldn't be underestimated. Again, here's all the other issues that we face. Okay, exposure to toxins and carcinogens, things we've already talked about. But at the very least, according to the NFPA guidelines, your gear needs to be turned in to either someone on your department who knows what the heck they're doing, that's actually been signed off by your manufacturer, or turned into an independent service provider to have their gear taken apart, make sure that there's no rips, there's no tears, the seams are all good, that the water barrier, the moisture barrier is intact. Right now, 21% of the gear that's being turned into my department is failing. 21% according to what I'm being told right now in a memo. 21% of our years being filled because we didn't do a very good job of this. Again, it's absorbed through the gear, and ultimately, we absorb it into our bodies. This is NFPA stating it now, folks. This is not just me. This is NFPA that's actually understanding this also. How many of you put your gear in the back of your car where you're going from one station to the next? You're going to go to a new station next shift. And so you throw it in the back of your car, and you had that big fire last night. And meanwhile, you got to go pick up the wife and the kids or whatever, or drop the kids off. And, Daddy, you were in a big fire last night? Yeah. Why? I smell it. It stinks. Well, you just now exposed your family and loved ones to that same carcinogens that we're trying to get rid of. Put it in a Tupperware box. Put it in the trunk so it's sealed up. Again, radiating heat. I don't understand the justification for black gear, except that it hides the dirt real well. Okay? PPE, more likely to conduct electricity if it's, contaminated. It's also likely to go up in flames at some point in time. I haven't heard of this, but obviously NFPA has. So, routine cleaning. You come out of a burning building, this isn't difficult, folks. Grab a brush, grab your booster line, grab a hose line, and rinse off. Get the big chunks off. Clean it up a little bit. I'm not saying you have to get it 100% clean, but at least get the major portion of it off. Okay? At the very least, start doing this after every single fire. If you're going to throw it in a washing machine, you at least need to know what you're doing with that. Temperature can't be more than 105 degrees. You have to have a certain pH factor. You have to run it through the cycle once, and you have to have it rinsed out twice. And oh, by the way, the washing machine you buy down at Sears or Kmart or whatever is not appropriate. It's supposed to be an extractor, okay, the front mount type thing. Drying procedures. Don't stick it out in the sun to dry. It breaks down the UV factor. It breaks it all down. Okay? And again, machine drying, 105 degrees. Why? I don't know. That's the way the manufacturer has written it. When you get to the advanced clean, this is where you don't have anything to do with it anymore. But they take it apart, and they look at it, everything, and they go through it. No chlorinations, pH factors have got to be correct. So, my department, over the years, didn't realize how bad this system was. Here's how easy it was for us to get our gear clean. Once a year, or twice a year, depending upon which year we were talking about, somebody, the ISP would come and drop off some boxes in the station. And that next morning, when you got off duty, all you had to do was take all your personal stuff out of your gear, drop it into the box. And 2 days later, when you came back on shift again, that gear magically appeared, and it was all nice and clean for you. Nicely folded, and everybody's gear was already clean. Done. Yet only 28 to 27 to 31% of our people would automatically just, yep, I'm in. I'm going to get my gear clean. If we had somebody chasing them, and we had a safety officer for a while that was chasing people, let me see your gear. Nope, you didn't clean it. We got a high incident of 51%. Well, we've changed ISP providers, we've changed chiefs, and that's now changing also. Now we're in the 75 to 80% range for people turning the gear in. But unfortunately, because of it, we're paying the price now. Like I said, 21 to 31% or 21% thereabout is flunking right off the bat. And as the guys come in to change out trucks because the truck broke down, they want to go pick up the car so they can get some lunch or something like that, logistics chief says, oh, by the way, come on over here and let me see your gear. And approximately 40 to 50% of that gear is failing right now. That hasn't gone to the ISP. The unfortunate issue is we like our gear dirty. We're the gladiators. We want it dirty. The better, the dirtier, the more salty is the issue. Here's a guy. You can see by his helmet that he never has cleaned his helmet, and his gear is just as bad. I hope this guy wasn't wearing it when he went in. Okay? This guy was bragging about how dirty his gear was and his helmet and all the rest, and it showed that, you know, he'd been a working guy for a long number of years. And the unfortunate part is we could keep perpetuating this. And the companies that provide us the safety factors keep perpetuating this. MSA at FDIC and at FRI in Chicago last week or 2 weeks ago now, this is their advertising. Well, okay, they sell MSA backpacks, but was this guy ever wearing it? Okay, I mean, what the heck? Where's the justification in here? And look at the helmet and everything else. And when you go talk to the sales guys, they go, oh, well, that's marketing. That's got nothing to do with us. That's got everything to do with you guys. That's the problem that we face. You young guys look at this and go, I'm going to look like him. Well, that's wrong. And that's got to change. Like I said, we like our gear dirty. It's considered a badge of honor. So we'll start wrapping it up. We're killing ourselves and we need to make some changes. What's wrong with this picture?
No gloves.
No gloves. Thank you. That's a young, studly look at me. I was good looking back in 1974. Starting that IV as a brand new paramedic. 14 gauge, antecubital. Let's go. Boom. We didn't know anything about bloodborne pathogens. We didn't know HIV and all that type of stuff. Okay? And yet, just like we are not talking right now, if you got blood and guts all over you, perfect. You know, hey, I was a macho firefighter, paramedic. Look at me, I was on big blood and guts. But since that, we've learned. We wouldn't think not to have gloves on. Probably a trauma sleeves, masks, duckbill, face mask, whatever. So we've changed because we've learned the hazards involved in this. RIP teams. Back when we started first talking about RIP teams, it was like two in and two out. There's going to be the new standard, folks. It's a safety issue. We have to address this. And you go, chief, there's only three of us in a truck or four of us in a truck. Two in, one standing by, one's at the pump panel. We can't do this. Yet this is now happening. Well, this is the new mentality that's got to get overcome. Look at that picture. Not one of those people is wearing a mask. Not one of them is wearing a mask. Okay, and the idiot in the white helmet, excuse me, chief, but the idiot in the white helmet hasn't bothered to tell him to mask up either, and he certainly doesn't have one either. Lead by example. The stuff in these bottles are free. They don't charge you by the minute, they don't charge you by the cubic foot, and if you run out, you've got more on the truck. And if the truck doesn't have more, I'm assuming you have an air truck that you can call in. What can we do differently? There is an alternative to overhaul. It doesn't have to be first in, last out, okay? City of Jacksonville, Kurt Wilson, who was the captain of the hazmat team down there, started recognizing the issue with City of Jacksonville and their cancer issues. And he started putting two and two together. He says, too many of their guys were taking their gear off, their SCBA, when they're doing overhaul. So he wrote it up in SOG. And basically, the reason for it was to reduce the potential for cancer in Jacksonville Fire and Rescue Department members by requiring 100% compliance with federal laws and regulations. Well, it's kind of somewhat similar to at least making you guys wear your SCBAs during overhaul. But the difference is here, it's a fresh crew that's going to roll in. Okay, so up here in the front, we have engine one in, engine two in. I'm not going to talk about the truckies, okay? You guys can get excused today. And engine three, you're just rolling in. Okay, and it takes you a little while, takes you a half hour, 45 minutes to put the fire out, and good old, you know, finally the chief says, hey, the fire's knocked out, everybody starts cooling down, and we're going to go into an overhaul mode, and this was a large, multi-story, house, that type of thing. And the crew says, hey, it got extended into the kitchen, we think we got it knocked out, we'll probably have to pull it down some. The chief says, okay, fine. And he raises the alarm off and he says, send me the overhaul team. The overhaul team is nothing more than a fire crew that's not been on that firefight. They're a fresh crew, they're clean, they're cool, they're collected, they're not thinking anything. And so the alarm officer raises them up and says, start rolling on this. And they're going to roll routine. No lights, no siren, they're not going to kill themselves, they're not going to kill their members. And they roll routine in. And the chief says, okay, by the way, you guys were first in. Start breaking down, reload the truck, clean up, go back to the station, take a shower, and be ready to go. Engine two, help them break down. And you guys got 30 minutes, go. And off you guys go. Okay, engine three, stand by with the hose and all the rest, and when engine four comes in, the cut team comes in, you'll assist them by at least giving them some water. And that's basically what they're doing. First crew's gone, second crew, you can start breaking down now, you can go, third crew, you're still staying by. And off you go, okay? And oh, by the way, since you're the cut team, here's what we're doing. Pull down the ceiling, check for extension, and make sure you monitor. Oh, by the way, you all know that you're wearing your CBA going in. They're also using electric blowers instead of gas PPV. Why? To reduce the CO levels. And they're monitoring. Now, the monitoring is not for them to determine whether they're going to take off their SCBA. That's not the case. The monitoring is to decide whether the scene is safe to turn over to the occupants or not. And they're documenting. They're documenting what they saw when they got there and what they got when they left. For two reasons. When they get there, at least they've got some sort of benchmark for the three guys to at least have the very least documentation. And at the end point, what it was when they turned it over. There's the report. That's what they're using. Okay, is it the best thing out there? No, we don't have a big enough or a portable enough machine that we can roll in and say, here's the 1,000 chemicals that we got exposed to or what's going on right now. But this is what they're using right now, and it's better than what most of us are doing. Wrapping it up in the final. I can't stress to you guys enough to do an annual physical. Start testing for PSA, start testing your colonoscopy, start looking for breast and cervix cancer and some of these other issues at least 10 years earlier than the general population. There are departments out there, from the time you get on, they're testing for all these things all the way through. There are departments out there that are doing complete WFI compliant physicals from the moment you get on to the moment you retire, period. I mean, they're testing for everything, all the different issues. What's good for you? That's what your department's got to decide. You and your department and your union, you've got to make the decision what you're going to be willing to pay for or not. Okay? But we have to understand that some of these cancers, we're getting far earlier than the general population and far more aggressive than the general population. And if we wait to that 50-year period to test for PSA and start looking at colonoscopies, we are going to lose people very quickly. So you need to start thinking of that. Always wear your gear on the fire scene from the moment you got on it to the moment you finish your overhaul. Your policy and procedure states that. Are you following it? Clean your PPE and shower as soon as possible after any working fire. And don't forget your glove and your hood and your helmet. Okay? Again, we talked about the issues. If I were to show you the stats on what's on your gloves and you think about it, your gloves are probably more contaminated than anything else that you have. Because you're dragging the hose, you're loading the gear, everything that's been contaminated in that fire is probably coming through your gloves. And if you're not using your gloves, then really shame on you. Elimination of the diesel exhaust. This is beyond you guys. This goes up to the upper management. But there's got to be better systems out there. Okay? When I walk into a station and the hose is kinked in such a fashion that it looks like a V, it's not sucking anything out. Okay? We need to change that. Move the PPE out of the truck bay areas and into separate ventilated rooms. Again, the same issue. Okay, you got an exhaust system. It works, but after 25 or 30 seconds, it's no longer working. You're exposing all your gear that's in that bay area to all the diesel exhaust that's left. Institute or enforce a safety mandatory OIC. Somebody's got to step up and say, you're not wearing your mask, you're not wearing your gear, put it on, period. I'm watching out for you. I may be the badass, excuse my French, I may be the bad person here. Take it for what it is, but this is what you're going to do. Again, we've talked about the Jacksonville concept. This is a big discussion that's going on right now at the upper levels of government. We need to have some sort of centralized database for following our firefighters that get diagnosed. Here's the problem. I'm now retired. I go in to see a doctor, or I go see the hospital to get treatment. Question becomes, occupation, retired. I'm no longer a firefighter. Once we retire, we suddenly have dropped right off the face of the earth. For those of you guys that have issues with the departments, and I'm not saying you guys, I'm not saying in Denver per se, I won't throw you under the bus. But the bottom line to it is, if you have a concern that you might get fired because you report your cancer issue, then that's a problem, okay? That's a problem. So obviously when you go in, you may not say, I'm a firefighter. You may just say, I'm Joe Citizen. We need to start tracking the cancers when they're diagnosed, the ages of our members when they're diagnosed, those type of issues, active and retired. We lose our retirees up to the age of 65, there's no question about it, because they then go into Medicare or Medicaid. But we need to start tracking this. This needs to be a national database. And there's discussions of a couple different departments that might open up their, quote, exposure reports to people across the country. California is a super program. We need to start documenting gas exposures, and you have to start filing your exposure reports. If you guys want your benefits from your cancer presumption law, you better be filling out some paperwork. Because I'm going to tell you right now, those attorneys are going to eat you up. I see it across the country. They will just absolutely eat you up. You must go work at the desk for the last 30 years. Show me where you've been on any fires. You've been on a fire? What kind? I know you guys saw this. This is typically part of my class, so I'm not going to go through it. But, you know, this is the guy that died of brain cancer in Washington State. So, insanity is doing the same thing over and again and expecting some type of different results. Okay, there's no chance that you can do the same thing over and over again and expect any type of different results. The choices you make today and into the future can and will have some sort of effect on your health and family. Okay, you need to understand you have to make these changes, or at least some of them. I'm not saying you have to do them all, but I've been to way too many of these things. 96 members died of cancer in my department, all of them since I got on the job. And 30 of those members that died of cancer were younger than me that came on the job after I did. This is the reality of what we face. Job for 34 years. I know some of these classes are real hard to sit through, and some of them, you know, you go, what the hell is the point of that? I hope you learned something out of this class, and I hope you take this back and share it with the other members who can't make it here. Unfortunately, I could only be here for a week. When I go back, I teach in Broward County for 2 weeks, which is Fort Lauderdale area. But again, I think this is important for us all to learn from, and I hope you've learned something. Thank you.